The National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated stations present The Pacific Story. This is the story of the Pacific, the drama of the millions of people who live around this greatest sea, where the United States is now committed to a long-term policy of keeping the peace. This is a documentary account of the situation in the Pacific, of the men and events which are today influencing the shape of world affairs for generations to come. Redemption in Singapore.
I had the feeling as I stood there that the naval yard of Singapore had always looked like this. Giant cranes lifting and lowering things, locomotives moving heavy loads back and forth, dockyard machinery, repair shops, men like ants working all over the great ships and the graving docks, swinging over the side in bosun's chairs, scrambling over the gun turrets, assembling equipment of the forecastle, scraping and painting the flying bridge.
All right, let's go the line below there. Take it up now. What's that?
I had the feeling that it has always been like this, and yet I knew so well it had not. I remembered what it had looked like after the bombing, the way places always look after bombing. Wreckage, rubble, steel twisted into fantastic tortured shapes, mangled machinery, craters like ugly wounds, and fire-blackened stumps of buildings. I remember what was said when Singapore fell.
To Britain, it is the greatest military disaster of the war, greater even than Dunkirk. At Dunkirk, the British Expeditionary Force lost all its equipment, but 80% of the personnel was saved. At Singapore, the British Empire lost a whole army of some 70,000, together with their equipment and the vast and costly naval base.
The loss of Singapore ranks for the breaching of the Maginot Line in France. As the breakthrough of the Sedan gave most of Europe to the Nazis, the fall of Singapore gave most of the Far East to the Japanese.
With the fall of Singapore and its $80 million naval base, the most powerful British bastion in the Far East has fallen into the hands of the Japanese.
I remembered that. But what I remembered more were those last few agonizing hours of resistance. The fighting in the streets, the overwhelming power of the Japanese surging over the island. And I remembered what followed.
Keep them robots, mate. Keep them moving.
Never yet, Pembroke.
Someone's got to sweep the streets.
Well, that's not why they're making us do it.
Stop your talking over there. Keep those fools moving.
They want us to lose face before all those Asiatics over there along the curb watching us.
Quiet, Clyde. He's watching us.
They know what they're doing.
Better than being put into a prison camp.
That'll come.
Stop that talking. Quick. Quick now.
Clyde was right. When we and all the other whites had swept the streets until the Japanese were satisfied, they degraded us before the Malays, the Chinese, the Indians, and all the other Asiatics in Singapore. They lined us up and herded us off to Chanji Criminal Prison.
Good heavens, how many of them are they going to crowd into this jail?
Get in there. Step quick.
Oh, all right, you don't have to push.
Get in there. Now, move ahead. Many more are coming.
How many of us do you estimate they've got crammed in here, Pembroke?
Oh, I'd say 3,000.
3,000? We built the place for 600.
There are more women and children than that in here now.
Aye.
What did you say about women and children?
I said there are more women and children in here now than this jail was built for.
Besides all us men.
If they're permitting women and children to be here, then why don't they allow my wife and two children
to... That isn't the idea. These women here have been taken from their husbands and children, and the children have been separated from their parents.
Oh, no, your wife and children are probably in one of the other prison camps.
What will happen to my children if they're separated from my wife?
Well?
They're so young, and my wife...
Oh, look, chum, take it easy.
I'm going to get out of here.
I'm going to get out
of
here.
Move ahead, all of you. You, move.
Don't hit me with that gun again.
The place was filthy. The sanitation facilities were inadequate. Buckets and garbage tins were used for cooking and distributing food. The jail was infested with bedbugs.
Seen Mackenzie the last couple of days?
No.
He's making drawings of the entire jail. And he's set down how many prisoners are locked up in each section.
Interesting pastime.
Well, he's figured out exactly how much space each one of us has.
How much?
8 feet by 3 feet.
8 feet by 3 feet.
Uh-huh. To live, move, breathe, eat, and sleep.
Hardly enough space to lie down.
Aye. Look at that over there. A sick woman. 2 sick kids. And no medical care.
There was no help for them. The woman and one of the children died. They were the first to go. Others followed. That made a little more space. The food was bad. There was not enough of it. We grew thinner. By looking at Clyde, I tried to estimate how much weight I'd lost. After a while, I didn't think of that anymore. Only of how to get more food.
I caught a snail last night in the dock. It was crawling on the wall.
There's everything crawling around in here, Shaw.
I ate it.
Ate the snail?
Yes.
A snail?
Yes. It was good. Gave me an idea. If we could catch some more, maybe we could raise snails. That's protein in them.
Not me. I'm going to get out of here. I'm going to find my wife and kids wherever they are.
We talked about food nearly all the time.
What about the stores of food that were accumulated for the siege? There was enough to last a couple of years.
Well, the Japanese must have found it by now.
A lot of it was underground.
They would find it.
That's an idea.
What?
Maybe if we tell them where it was, maybe we could make a deal with them. And they'd give us some of it. Well, maybe they would, eh?
Maybe. We've nothing to lose and everything to gain. I'm going to tell them.
Try to make a deal with them. Try to make a deal with them.
Clyde told one of the guards. And then we waited.
Pembroke, you will come with me.
I?
Yes, you, Pembroke. Come with me.
Guard!
Yes?
Remember that food?
What food?
Those hidden stores of food I told you about 2 weeks ago. Are we going to get some of it?
I know nothing about food.
I told you. Didn't I, man? Didn't I? I told you about the food that the British had stored away. And you said we'd get some of it.
I know nothing about food. Come, Pembroke. You come with me.
The commander questioned me about my work in the rubber industry before the Japanese had come. Who were the others among the prisoners who'd worked in the rubber industry? Whatever the purpose behind this, he cunningly concealed it. I said my work had brought me in contact with few people, that I knew no one among the prisoners who'd worked in rubber. But I knew by the time they took me back that something was afoot. I tried to figure out what they were after. If it concerned rubber, it would probably concern a man named Jenkins, R.O. Jenkins, an expert on rubber who was in Chanji prison. From where I sat, I could see him. I knew that if I talked to him, I would betray him. And just at twilight, Bryson sidled up to me.
Here, take this paper.
I took it. I dropped it. I put my foot on it.
It's from Jenkins.
What is it?
It's a plan for the rehabilitation of the Malayan rubber industry.
A plan?
Yes. He got word from the governor, Sir Shenton Thomas, to work out the plan to get the industry working immediately after the counterattack regains Singapore.
But what does he want me to do? Bryson was gone. When I looked around, Clyde was watching me.
Is that the rubber plan?
Yes.
McKenzie? MP knows it's around. They'll be looking for it.
I see.
It's been moving around for days. I had it last week. It's going to be bad for the one who's caught with it. The MP is furious that we'd even think of getting the rubber plantations back.
The MP were secret police. That night in the dark, I hid the plan under a stone in my space. Bryson came back to talk to me.
I passed it on to you, Pembroke, because I'm getting out.
You're getting out. I can't stay here while my wife and kids... What was that?
Nothing. Listen. This is the second plan Jenkins has drawn up. The first one he hid in sections in different places. He thinks one of the sections fell into the hands of the Japanese commander here. But the Japanese don't know who made the plan. That's what they're after. They've taken out 3 prisoners in the last week and tortured them to find out. Take care of it. I'm going.
Bryson left. I didn't know if he meant he was going to try to escape that night or what. I lay awake for hours in the dark, my insides gnawing with hunger, thinking about him and Jenkins' plan. Just before dawn, I was waiting. The Kempe was raiding the place.
Stay right where you are.
As the Japanese closed in on me, I could see them moving out in all directions through the jail.
Stage is close there on the wall.
Yes, sir.
Now, stand still. Do not move.
They dragged every stitch off me, and as my rags were thrown down, they went over them, inch by inch. What they did to me, they did to all the others around.
Get out of the way. Bring it.
They asked no questions, only searched. My heart pounded. I kept looking up for fear I'd look at the stone. They pushed it. They stepped on it. They stepped over it. There were other stones around the courtyard. They ignored them
all.
May
I hear somewhere?
And at last they left. Simply walked out. As I pulled on my few rags, Clyde came over to me.
Bryson is dead.
What? Bryson?
He tried to escape to join his family. They shot him.
I got the plan back to Jenkins. He destroyed it. The food became worse. The filth, the misery, the vermin, the illness, the terror became worse. We saw no more cats or dogs. Ben Shaw, the prisoner who had eaten the snail, waited for weeks to capture more. With the help of other prisoners, he started a snail farm. They herded them together and husbanded them like livestock.
There's protein in them. And pretty soon, if we have good luck, we're going to have enough for an ounce of snail meat for every prisoner in this jail every day.
By 1943, we were getting reports from the outside that there was such a shortage of food in Singapore that the Japanese were dumping many people onto the mainland to ship for themselves.
Look at this, Pembroke. Where did you get that? A Chinese outside cashed a check for me.
A Chinese gave you money for a check?
Aye. He charged me 10% to cash it, but he cashed it. They'll cash checks for any British officer.
No Chinese would cash a check without being pretty sure of getting his money back.
Right. This means they're certain that Singapore will be recaptured.
Get in there. Find yourself a place.
Just as you say.
They pushed in a haggard wreck of a man. He stood inside the door looking at all of us with his hollow eyes, his shaggy hair blended into his beard. His mouth hung open. He just stood there, looking. After a while, he sank down and sprawled out on the floor. Clyde and I went over to him. His clothes were in rags. We gave him some water. All we could find out from him was that his name was Cope.
They questioned me for weeks. I told them nothing. Nothing.
It was plain that he'd been tortured. We cleared a state for him near ours. We took care of him as well as we could. There was no medical help, whatever. He just lay there, ate a little of his food. He left most of it, which we ate. We asked him no questions. But when he was sleeping, sometimes Clyde and I talked about him.
He knew out here. Mark my words.
What makes you think so?
I don't know. The way he behaves, what he says.
Little by little it came out. He was a British officer. Home was in Doncaster. He could come out to India in the Southeast Asia Command as a liaison officer. And in the dead of night, he parachuted down into Malaya, 200 miles up the Malay Peninsula from Singapore.
I was supposed to make contact with some other liaison officers who had dropped into Malaya some months before. I made contact with him by radio. When I got to the rendezvous point, they were not there. The Japanese lay back until I was in the trap. Then they jumped me.
Brought you here for questioning, eh?
No. They took me to the nearest post, Port Swettenham, up the street. Then Kuala Lumpur. Then down here.
We listened when he talked, and when he stopped, we said nothing. We were too tired, too weak to ask questions. The Japanese guards strutted around among us on their daily tours of inspection.
They wouldn't strut if they knew what I know.
No, I'll bet they wouldn't.
No, you bet they wouldn't. They know they're going to be thrown out of here. But they won't admit it even to themselves.
No.
The day we move back into Singapore, we're going to be in operation from the first day.
I thought of the wreckage of the naval base, the docks and the port facilities blasted into rubble.
We're getting everything ready. We're building floating docks up to 50,000 tons in India. And we'll tow them in and start using them the day we take over. We've built a monster mobile naval radio station. Momonster, we call it. With office equipment, power supply, and with more than 100 ratings trained and ready to land within 24 hours of occupation.
These things are ready now? This mobile radio station and the docks?
Ready. In India, right now.
Gad.
Yes. We'll move in with oil tanks, with floating pipelines, so the tankers can discharge their cargoes offshore. We bring in a water purification plant to start supplying water from almost the first minute.
Then we can be expecting them here any time, eh?
I didn't say that.
With that, he shut up like a clam. I looked across the cell block. One of the Japanese guards was looking at him out of the corner of his eyes. Clyde changed the subject to the snail farm, and I joined him in the conversation.
They've been eating them for centuries in France.
You get used to them.
And after all, their protein, that is something like it.
Cope didn't talk again for days, but by this time he'd come to understand the hope that his words brought to all of us in Changi.
We're prepared to move in a laundry, a canteen, and a cinema. And a mobile bakery and refrigerators have been ordered. And two frigates have been outfitted in England as floating power stations to be used in case the shore power stations are destroyed. Even huts for personnel are waiting in India for the day we take back Singapore. And plans have been worked out for a mobile naval airbase and cranes and dockyard machinery and tools, locomotives and repair stores. Everything will be ready, and even personnel have been informed.
By 1944, reports were filtering into us of what was happening outside.
They are beginning to realize that their new order is not a success.
How do you know, Shaw?
Some of those attained to my snail farm had outside contact.
Oh?
There are no food reserves. There are no vegetables in the market. Although the Japanese have tried to force the Chinese and the Malays to grow more food. There's almost no fish. The military has taken most of it. There is little rice and no flour and no bread.
How is the war going?
The Americans have landed in the Philippines.
Oh.
We took heart. We learned about the progress of the fighting in the Philippines, of the British carrier-borne raids on Sumatra. And then one day, we looked up and saw Allied planes over Singapore.
Those are British planes from Burma.
Then we must have bases in Burma again.
In the months that followed, they kept coming back.
Look, those are heavy bombers. Yes, yes, those are American super forts. They're based in India.
They plastered the naval base, left the city almost untouched. The raids continued. It was 1945 now. Summer and the heat was unbearable. There was more space now in Chanji prison.
The Japanese must be losing. The guards are almost civil.
I think we could escape. They'd kill you if you tried.
Is that worse than this?
Remember Bryson? Oh, no. No, that was before your time.
They killed him, I suppose.
Aye.
They were more sure of themselves then.
We could feel the end was coming. Escape was in the air. And then Shaw got word from the outside.
The war's over.
Hmm?
Japan surrendered.
What? How do you know?
The U.S. dropped some kind of a new bomb on one of their cities and they surrendered.
One bomb?
Yes, one bomb. And the Japanese have surrendered to the Allied forces in Tokyo.
Impossible.
It's true. It's true. Oh. The war's over.
The war's
Japan
over.
Surrendered.
Oh. Japan surrendered.
Quiet, quiet. The war's
over. Stop it, Japan. Silence. Can I all of you? Down on your faces.
The war's over. The war's over. Japan surrendered.
Down on your face. Down.
Now, you. You mean me?
Yes, you. Drag him out. Drag him out the door.
No, take hold of him. Drag him out.
The floor was smeared with blood from Shaw's head as Cope dragged him out.
Did you see that gash in his head?
Yes.
The war's over for him, all right. He's dead.
That was the last time we saw those two Japanese. And then word filtered in that the war had ended. The Japanese naval officers had boarded HMS Nelson, the flagship of the British task forces in that area, to provide data for safe passage from the Straits of Malacca to Singapore. We didn't wait for formal release from Changi. That night, we slipped out of the prison. A Chinese hid us.
You had better not go out. The war's over, isn't it?
Singapore is still full of Japanese, ready to fight and kill. And General Itagaki, the commander, has said that he will not surrender Singapore.
He's been ordered to surrender by Field Marshal Taraochi.
But he has said he will not surrender. If you are seen on the streets, you will be killed.
The next day, we learned that Admiral Mountbatten, supreme commander in Southeast Asia, had warned Field Marshal Taraochi that he would be held responsible if General Itagaki did not surrender. We laid low another day.
British warships have dropped anchor in the harbor.
What?
Actually,
let's get down there at once. Come on. We walked openly out into the streets. We went down to the battered waterfront. And there, for the first time since February 1942, there were British men of war in the stream. The harbor in ruins, the battle fleet at anchor, frowning down upon us. General Itagaki went aboard and signed an agreement for the occupation of the city. And for the next 2 days, we watched more and more vessels come in. Cargo carriers and auxiliaries as well as warships.
Look, the first landing craft are coming in.
That's the 5th Indians. The division that fought in Libya, Italy and Burma.
We stood on the main wharf of the Empire docks and waited for them to land. Once these were the busiest commercial wharves in Singapore. Now there was not a merchant ship dock there. And the Empire troops were coming in.
They're in full battle dress. Look at them.
Jeeps and Gurkhas.
Hurrah for the Indian prisoners! Hurrah!
The prisoners of war, the civilians, the Chinese on the Empire docks roared with joy.
Ah!
The Japanese guards stood by, watching it all with smiles on their faces. But not for long.
Well, I'll be.
Major General Mantek ordered them to work.
Sweeping the streets just as you and I did, eh, Pembroke?
Yes. The Japanese are not only to sweep the streets, they're to fill in the trenches and help in the cleanup work generally.
Chinese and Malayans along the curb over there watching them. Just as they watched us, Pembroke.
Yes. That's all it's for.
Aye. Restoration of faith.
And that same day, General Itagaki made a statement.
Oh, we hope the peace will last for 20 years. Then we will be back again.
Back in 20 years. I looked around me. The wreckage, the desolation, the black misery. And I thought of the suffering of what Singapore had been. The great distributing center for Britain's eastern commerce. A port served by 80 steamship lines, 30,000 ships entering the harbor each year, one of the world's great naval bases, the operating center of a powerful defensive fleet. And I looked at the ruination. Back in 20 years. The municipal building was untouched by destruction. And there on September the 12th, 1945, it all ended.
You'll never forget this day, Pembroke.
Never.
Look, representatives of the United States, the Netherlands, Australia, France, China. Aye, and Japan.
Yes.
I say, Itagaki is getting ready to sign. Aye, they never dreamed they'd ever know this kind of humiliation.
When it was done, General Itagaki had surrendered his 85,000 troops in Malaya and the 500,000 troops in Southeast Asia and in the Indies under Field Marshal Terauchi. And now it is 1946. A year and more has passed. The blasted docks and the naval installations are whole again. The twisted steel, the wreckage, and the rubble are gone. The craters filled in, the blackened buildings rebuilt. And now again, rubber and tin and quinine and 100 other things needed by people everywhere are flowing through Singapore. I have the feeling, standing here looking at it, that it has always been like this. And yet I know so well. It has not.
You've been listening to The Pacific Story, presented by the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations, to clarify events in the Pacific and to make understandable the cross-currents of life in the Pacific Basin. For a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. To repeat, for a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. The Pacific Story is written and produced by Arnold Marquis. The music was scored and conducted by Henry Russell. The principal voice was that of Hans Conried. Programs in this series of particular interest to servicemen and women are broadcast overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. This program came to you from Hollywood and is heard in Canada over the facilities of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.